I was somehow got separated from my liaison team in, must have been September of 1987, and found myself billeted with the forward command group of 3-2 Battalion. And together with a guy called Piet van Sail, Captain Piet van Sail, famous Piet Boer, was asked by Jan Huygaard to do a recce into the area where 4-7 Brigade was cornered and got taken out during the course of a day and a night. And we drove into this heavily wooded, previously heavily wooded area as daylight broke, and found ourselves in the middle of what then looked like Delville Wood. You know, it was the position where they had drawn lager. And I think in the previous day they were taken out by, they were heavily bombarded by SAF Mirages, by the G5 cannons, by MRLs, or MLRs, MRLs. And during the course of that night, they'd actually tried to escape. This was just on the heavily wooded area next to the floodplain. In any case, when we, as I said, when we arrived there, it was the remnants of the brigade, and it looked like it looked some serious damage was inflicted. Anyway, we walked out just past the tree line and looked out over the floodplain, and that floodplain was about a kilometer. And in the distance, we could see where the vehicles had gotten stuck in the mud, and as they tried to cross. With the binoculars, I spotted what looked in this haze, in this morning light, like SA8, and I recognize that because of my background. I was a ground-to-air missile type. And realized what it was, and got onto the radio, back to headquarters, and said, listen, I think this is what we've got. They didn't believe me. So Pete and I decided to take a walk out, you see. Yeah, so anyway, we walked across. We had a couple of UNITAs that accompanied us, a couple of UNITA soldiers. We got there and noticed that these things had actually bogged down in this mud, while the one was trying to tow the other. It was the actual SA-8, the launching platform. And then there was another vehicle, SA-8 vehicle, with a missile carrier, with a couple of missiles in it. And the one was trying to tow the other. Like, they both got bogged down. And Pete Boer was a farmer, and he used to drive D8 bulldozers. And he noticed a tank standing close by, and this tank was still idling. He said that he could drive this thing. And so we got the tank in position, and we uncoupled the two vehicles, and they were totally lying flat on their stomachs in this mud, and started hauling out the first one. Well, I think at that stage, the 21 Brigade was across the road in the tree line across the other side of the river, and they must have noticed that there was something going on, and obviously started bombarding us. Anyway, we. First vehicle we took out up to the tree line, came back for the second one, I got that out. And I think we went back for a total of about 6 or 7 trips, trying to get as much stuff as we can, and logging, and by then headquarters was onto us, and trying to get a picture of what was on the ground. And we finally just got crazy, you know. I mean, MiGs were rolling in, they were really, I think they got some sort of instruction. We believe later in the intercepts that they were told to stop us at all costs. Anyway, we finally left the scene and spent the night with the vehicles in the place where we parked them and camouflaged them. And that night we towed. The one was drivable, funny enough. The missile vehicle was, you could still drive. We figured that out. Drove that on its own, and the actual SA-8 pit towed with a tank to a position about 30 kilometers from there where Jan Huygout was. And the following day, they flew now Mossy Besson with everybody else who was a technical type to come and have a look at these things. And there they stayed for a couple of days. And I know UNITA was under huge pressure from the Americans to get these systems. But eventually, with the help of again of 3-2 Battalion, we had a whole protection force. Finally, we got it all the way back to the brigade headquarters, and from there, of course, it was recovered later.
In the end, after this maneuver, we were so close to Ketuganaval that. From a MiG taxiing on the runway until it was above us ready to throw its bombs, it was something like 3 minutes or something like that. You know, we were very close to them. And during this stage, at one morning, you know, we were traveling right through the night, and when the sun came up, we were still traveling, and everyone knew that it was extremely dangerous, but our commander got lost, so he carried on traveling. And you know, you cannot just stop, you have to follow them, otherwise you get lost, you don't know where you're going to, you don't know anything, you just travel in the convoy. So what happened at this stage was he explained to us that we had to wait where we were, and he went forward. He didn't give clear instructions, he just said wait, you know. At that stage, some of us decided that we were going to camo the vehicles. The problem with that was if you do camo the vehicle, the camo net gets stuck in the bushes and in the vehicle and everywhere. You cannot just roll it up within 5 minutes and get going again. It takes a while to clear this up again. So we were not sure, you know. If he came back and said, rush, go, then we would not be able to. But on the other hand, while we were sitting there, we were totally exposed. So a few of us decided that we were not taking the risk, we were going to camo it anyway. I was busy camoing, rolling out the net and putting in bushes and stuff, when I heard fighter aircraft. And at that stage, because of our experiences, you know, when you hear fighter aircraft, you know it's extreme danger. So while I was standing on top of the truck, camoing, I heard this. When I looked up, I saw one aircraft flying very low and very slow, coming over us. You know, basically the direction we were traveling in, he came in the opposite direction over us. And I stood there and I watched, and I didn't hear him turn around or anything. So I got the impression that because he was so low, you know, he was looking maybe further out from the aircraft, and he didn't see us right below him. But what I didn't know was that he did spot us. And what I heard afterwards was that this was a Russian pilot. And then he turned around, he radioed in. And when he came in for the second run, there was already Afrikaans, they call it the escadron. I'm not sure what you call it in English. A whole group of aeroplane already bombed up and taking off and ready on their way towards us. As I said, we were not so far from Kutukanoval at that stage, so they could reach us quite quickly. Then when he came in for the second run, I just climbed off the truck. I was standing next to the truck, and I saw the aircraft coming in. Now, at that stage, we were traveling all night. We were all of us extremely tired. You know, the dust, this fine dust, and the dust sits in your eyes. You know, it causes mud, and you rub your eyes. You know, you in a bit of a state. But anyway, I was standing there, and I was watching this MiG come over. I think it was a MiG-21 or MiG-23. I'm not absolutely sure. And I saw the bomb underneath it detach. And it started falling slowly. It was quite a big bomb, you know. It was either 500-pound or 1,000-pound bomb. And it was falling for a while, and then I saw a parachute behind it deploy. And at that stage, I'm not sure if it was the tiredness or the whatever, but I was, you know, I was just stuck there. I was just standing watching and didn't register what was going on. So I saw this bomb fall, and then it exploded. It was one massive explosion. You know, from where I stood, I would guess about 100 meters, you know, just a ball of flame. And then after that, I heard somebody screaming. And only then did it start, you know, registering, you know, this was going on. I was standing there right next to a truck full of ammunition, you know, just watching this. And then I rushed in. The bomb hit just behind the turret on the body of the Aratel, and it went in. It was so big, the explosion, that it broke the we call it the romp, and it went in. Okay. The guy that was taking the water, the gunner, he's, if I can quickly explain, this part of his leg was shot away. Only the tendon at the back was there. And the piece of the leg that was, you know, it was like he had his boots and his socks and everything on. It went through his browns, his socks and his boots, like a knife through butter. You know, it was cut clean. You know, there wasn't even threads or anything sticking out. It was clean cut. And the part of the leg, you know, that was cut off, you could see the bones and the fat and the flesh sticking out. But anyway, he was the guy that was screaming. The driver that was lying inside, the Jager, the shrapnel of the explosion pierced his body all over. For example, in the back of his head, there was a piece of shrapnel that went into the floor, you know, underneath the grid, and then ricocheted into his head. As I said, Duncan Taylor took him out, and he carried him away a few meters. And then I rocked up there, you know, I took a stretcher and I ran there, and then we put him on the stretcher, and then the medics came and they started helping him. So Fricky was lying there, you know, his beard was singed by the explosion, and he was full of holes. You could see the holes, and you see the blood, you know, spreading around it. And he was pleading with us to help him, you know, he was moaning over the pain and pleading with us to help him. And we were just watching him, you know, there was nothing we could do. You know, we tried to console him a little bit and tell him, you know, be patient, you know, the help is on its way and stuff like that, you know, but it wasn't real much of a help. And also because we were so far into Angola and we couldn't have air support, the choppers could only come in at night to Kazovac. Used to, we call it Kazovac casualty evacuation. So it took him about 8 hours to die. And only after nightfall the choppers came in, so he was already dead by then. The other guy, I cannot remember his name right now, the gunner that lost his foot, he was also lying there in pain, and you know, because we used to Kazovac, all our injured and all our dead, they just left it there to rot. So the flies were terrible, you know, there was, yes, you know, it was bad. So we tried to, you know, make it as comfortable as possible for them, but for example, Fricky, they gave him 3 morphine injections before he could really, you know, lie still, you know, they could work with him. But yes, that's the way things worked out, you know, there was bad things, and then in some miraculous way, you know, it worked out well as well.
that day, you know, you have moments of absolute terror and moments of hysterical laughter, and I think that's your body's way of calming itself, you know, in times of stress like that. But you know, seeing a guy who's desperately needs the toilet in the middle of a shootout is not fun, because the door opens, he's trying to do his thing, and then a mortar lands and he's jumping back into the vehicle and he hasn't finished yet. But, and you know, something like that, it's amazing how hysterically funny that becomes to you, you know. And I mean, you see incidents like that which I suppose just relieve the stress you're going through, you know. But it was extremely funny. And I mean, I've only got a little window that big to look out of in the rattle. And I mean, I saw this happening, and I just burst out laughing. And but you know, you could also see the terror on the guy's face, you know, as he's jumping back into the vehicle and he's already hitting the hydraulic switch to close the door, you know. And then, you know, you also pick it up on the radio. You know, you can hear the guys that are starting to panic, you know, and they start getting talking, almost shouting over the radio and stuff. And but all in all, you know, the when you have the 120 mil mortars being placed there with the and their base plates being a rattle itself, and you seeing a whole lot of the enemy trying to run across a shorner to get away, it was most satisfying at the time, you know. You don't look at it as another human being almost. It's just like, that's the enemy, and take as many out as possible, you know.
47th Brigade was crushed. And that marked the end of the FOPLA advance. They were effectively stopped. Although FOPLA at that point did not give up on the offensive, they decided to regroup. So they retreated their forces and to form more or less a defensive perimeter around the bridge at Kwitukonewal, if you want to call it. So they deployed forces to the sources of the Mianai River, and there we had a very interesting thing. When these troops were moving down, we knew their movements so well. We know exactly the speed at which they move when they're in the advance. And we were picking up on the radio that the communications between the front tank commanders who were leading the advance. So we knew the position where they started, but there was no eyes on them. So we couldn't see where these guys were. There were no artillery observers that could see their movements and so on. But we guessed it. And we calculated, okay, they should be more or less in this area. We plotted it on a map, and we gave those coordinates through to the artillery, who started firing. In the meantime, our guys were listening to the tank commander reporting, and he would report, shots landed 50 meters to the left of me. We would then tell the artillery, move the fire 50 left, until the radio went quiet. That was, yeah. And that tactic was used several times, where we used their own communications and the way they reported on our fire to hit them.
And then I came back, and then saw out my remaining days, which I hated. I just hated being back in Pretoria, you know, with all that, you know. And you think, oh, you know, what we've been through and the experiences we've had, and there's a lot more, you know. I could probably talk for days about it, but, you know, and then you get some guy who shouts at you to get up in the morning to, you know, for inspection and all that, and you think, well, you know, this guy hasn't kind of stepped out of Pretoria and has no idea what a lot of the guys here had been through. And he's shouting, giving orders, you know, that used to upset the guys, you know. And I know it upset me quite a lot. I mean, you didn't say anything about it, because you know, the training and that and the discipline was so well structured in the Defence Force. You know, you never argued. And you just often felt like these guys have no idea. They've never been up there. And you often used to think about civilians as well like that, you know. You know, you'd go and you'd, I don't know, something arbitrary. You're getting someone to hoot at you because you've waited too long at the robot, you know, and you're trying to think, guys, you know, do you know what we've all been through here for your safety and you treat us like this? And I know it sounds rather petty now, but I think at the time, you know, it was probably a bit more emotional afterwards than people thought. And we never spoke about it. We never spoke about it. I mean, this is the first time I've ever spoken about it since then. So we're going back some years now, eh? And it's not that we didn't, well, it's not that I didn't want to talk about it. It was just never raised, you know? And it's not like I want to be seen as going out, oh, you know what, we did this and we did that and we fought here and we fought there, almost like this kind of Rambo thing, you know? And, but it's not that I didn't want to talk about it either. It just never got asked of us, you know? As you say, you know, a lot of people have no idea.
Yeah.
Absolutely no idea what actually happened there and what a lot of the guys went through, you know?
I did at least 4 or 5 camps. When I finished doing my conscription, I then worked for a refinery in Durban as a process technician. And then in 1983, I resigned after 3 years of work, or 2.5 years of work, and I came overseas and went back to Durban in South Africa and studied journalism. And then I really started to understand, and a lot of my colleagues in journalism had fought. They actually were members of the UDF and the ANC then. And so I just got a really good understanding of what the politics and war was all about. So I tried to avoid going to camps. However, when I was working at Republican Press as a journalist, and I'd managed to stay away for at least 2 years, eventually I had the military police come right into my office and said, okay, you need to report. So I went to the editor and I said, what do I do? He said, it's up to you. So it was just before June 1986, which was 10 years of the Soweto uprising. And I was going to Grahamstown, First City. So reluctantly, but also with a little bit of interest, I went and I did this camp. And I pointed out to a very understanding lieutenant in Grahamstown that I explained exactly how I felt. I said, look, I really don't want to get involved. And he said, if you don't want to carry a rifle, but you can be our scribe for the platoon. So I thought that was okay. We went into Soweto, and it was actually on June the 16th, 1986, 10 years after. And basically all I had to do was every single day just write a log, write a report of where we'd gone and hand it to him. And I think he actually just, he didn't need to do that. He just kind of maybe empathized with me. So I was preparing these daily reports for him and reporting on what we saw in the Soweto. But it was on June the 16th that there was a roadblock that our platoon set up right outside the Orlando Stadium. And it was after dark. It was dark. And I was sitting in the back of the vehicle kind of just saying, you know, what the hell am I doing here? And then I heard squealing of tires and a few rifle shots. So I jumped out the back of the vehicle, ran around to see what had happened, and at the stopper group in the front of the roadblock, they'd seen a vehicle come down the hill towards the stadium, and the vehicle stopped, put the reverse gear, and then started to pull away. So these guys fired like a warning shot, apparently, and then they fired 3 shots through the windscreen. And that will stick in my mind forever, because in the Soweto, the newspaper the next day, was the headline was, I've seen it, was a young married mother with a child on her lap, and they'd been shot. She'd been shot, the baby had been shot through the head, and she'd been shot through the heart with one round. And then I was really pissed off. So I went to the lieutenant, I said, I'm not going back into that township now. And basically stayed in the camp for the rest of the trip. And I went back to Durban. I went to go and see my old lecturer at the Technicon where I did my journalism, and his name's Clive Emden. I said, what do I do? It's already been reported, but I really don't know what I should do. And he said, look, it's up to you. So I lived with that. And then probably 4 or 5 years later, maybe 91, I did one more camp, and that was in Ondongwa, funnily enough, at my old, you know, the main camp for Oshigombe operated out of. And I met a bunch of good guys. We had fun, drank a lot of beer. We were mortars, we were based in the base, and we were attacked one night, but no damage was done to anybody. That was it, yeah.
The way we experienced it, you know, it was like two politicians sitting around a table playing chess, and the one guy was saying, okay, now you've taken one of my pieces, I'm going to show you, and push 1,000 men into the bush. You know, they never saw us, they never knew us, they didn't worry about our experiences or backgrounds. And it was just a situation of, okay, Cuba is trying to show us something, now we're going to show them something, you know. They're playing around. It was like a political game. So we were very demoralized and very negative about the whole situation. If I have to look back now, I would say that it was important and it needed to happen. Because it's easy to say that when we withdrew, SWAPO took over Namibia anyway, what we were fighting for, you know, was undone anyway. But if we did not keep up, you know, we had big successes. The operations before us also had, you know, big successes. But if that did not happen, then maybe South Africa would be totally different now. Because at that stage, there was still a Cold War, you know. If say, for example, South Africa came under indirect Russian rule, you know, it would have been a totally different situation here today. So we did what we had to do. And at that stage, it was not a very good system. Although I believe that the National Service was a good system to train the people, to get the young guys focused and motivated, and, you know, make men out of them. But everything was fun and good, you know, built us up until there we make contact and you see the guys lying there wounded, you know, because we got guys back that was, you know, wounded and shot to pieces. And the guys that died, you can live with that, you know, because it's final. But the guys that's wounded, you know, we were 18, 19 years old at that stage. That used to stick with us, you know, that used to do, you know, it took your mind. Saw the guys cracking and stuff like that.
Tussen bosse en bome, tussen grense wag ons allemaal vermoorde. Maar op 18 was ons allemaal verloren. Hoe kan ons verstaan? En wie vlieg nou ons leven? Wat net God alleen weet waarom ons beeft. Samal net lewe, net een slag toe was jou lewe verby. Roep jy na my, roep jy my terug na die kaplyn, my vriend. Deur die jare het die wêreld gedraai, toe ons jong was, hoe sou ons dit kon raai. Soek jy na my, soek
jy my nou in die stof en jou bloed. Jy het gesê jy hoor hoe God na jou roep. Toes dit alles verby. Na al die jare ver verlore dinkels rond in ons dade. Met soldaten leef met grenzes en skade. Hoe kan ons verstaan? Want die bos vreet ons spore. In die donker bos was broeders gebore. In die donker saam gebid vir more. En teen slag toe was jou leven verby. Roep jy na my? Roep jy my terug na die kaplijn, my vriend?
Gonna hurt you some when you play with